Good evening. Welcome to All About Auckland. I'm Kane Glass. Tonight we share David Roberts' ambition to move the flying boats from Motet back to their home base at Mechanics Bay.
Well, it seems an extremely appropriate place to put the solar flying boat.
And then I discuss the role of the Port of Waitemata in this post-industrial age. Mechanics Bay was Tasman Empire Airways flying boat base from 1940 to 1960, and during that time it was New Zealand's airline gateway to the wider world. This history has been forgotten in Auckland's collective memory. David Roberts is leading the charge to move the flying boats from Motet back to Mechanics Bay.
So I'm talking today with David Roberts, whose father, Sir Geoffrey Roberts, was instrumental in setting up Teal, the first international airline in New Zealand. Just give us a little bit of the background to your father's history.
Well, he set himself with the ambition in about mid-1925-26 that he wanted to be an administrator in the airline business, not particularly a pilot or anything like that. And he pursued that ambition for 20 years before he actually achieved it through the his RAF experience, which he joined purely and simply to learn to fly, because he thought that was necessary if you were going to be running an airline. And then he went through the worked in the rubber industry, worked in the fuel industry, and finally in 1946 he won the opportunity to take up the general managership of Teal at a point where it had was in the process of being funded by the English, New Zealand and Australian governments.
So here we are at Teal Park in Mechanics Bay. What was the connection with Mechanics Bay and Teal Park?
Teal Park was established after the Teal site had been taken over by the container wharf. And it's just a little memorial to the what went on and the history of the flying boat services that flew out of Mechanics Bay. Teal was set up in 1946, it must have been, I'm unsure of that, but it was established with funding from the British, Australian and New Zealand governments. And it was a very serious start to New Zealand's international airline. And it faced a number of difficulties initially, but they were all overcome, and it just grew from there.
So Union Steamship Company of New Zealand, as I understand it, set Teal up and before the war, and it became a diplomatic shuttle service during the war.
As I have heard from my father, that would probably be a reasonable explanation of what went on. I understand that diplomats used it, naturally enough, and even one or two Japanese prisoners of war were returned on the Teal flights.
So as a kid you must have come down here and played around the old buildings and been involved with your father's work. What was it like?
Well, it was all very interesting to a 10-year-old, and into the workshops and across the flying boats, and they had an engine testing house down here, which upset one or two of the people that live up on the Parnell Rise, because the noise was constant through there. And I remember my father getting a ring from a lady who complained about it all, and then he said, well, you don't need to worry, because we'll be moving on out to Whenuapai very shortly. And she said, oh, are you? I've been very sorry, I'll be missing you.
Well, it's a great sight. Some of those photos, there's one up on the screen now, five flying boats moored out here.
Yes.
It must have been busy.
Yes. I don't remember five flying boats, because they were even a little bit before my time, because amongst those, well, there might have been one or two RNZAF Sunderlands as well, because Teal, of course, started off with Sunderlands, and then it went to a plane called the Sandringham, this is roughly speaking, and then they bought the Solents, which became the sort of the signature of...
They were the workhorse.
They were the workhorses, that's right. They carried about 35 to 40 people, I'm not quite sure. And as a young boy, I used to stand at my father's office door, right behind Mr. Sullivan, who was the customs officer who checked these people out when they arrived. And, I saw it all happening. You don't get behind the customs officer these days if you're just a visitor.
So when Teal was operational, this base would have been essentially the full service. This was where the flying boats were serviced.
Everything happened here, yes, yeah.
So tell us a bit about the vision that you've got for the remaining flying boats out at Motap.
Well, it seemed an extremely appropriate place to put the Solent flying boat here and finish it off its restructuring. And the public will see it when they go by. It's within a couple of hundred yards of where they used to operate. It's looking out up the Waitemata Harbour there, which is where they used to take off from. And it's part of the heritage of Auckland. It's the beginnings of Air New Zealand, Auckland's international airline, which is a large organisation these days.
And it'll be a fantastic place for people to come and visit, wouldn't it? I mean, in terms of drawing the public, it's right on the waterfront, hugely important area.
I think so. This is. We all want to go home at some stage in our lives, and this flying boat's, this is home to that flying boat. Yeah.
Oh, well, let's just take a bit of a walk around.
I think that this is the vista, this is the Waitemata. This is where the flying boats took off up there. They didn't go down this way at all. They were heading out to as much open space as they could. And before any plane took off, they had to take a launch up the flight path, the takeoff path, and search for logs and things like that on the water. The lie of the land down here is such that it would be a very easy site to build on. It's got everything going for it. I see it tying in. You mentioned Meccano. I see it tying in with Meccano a little bit. There could be a reception centre administered by them for many conferences, and Air New Zealand would surely like to bring their guests, or if they're having a gathering of some sort or another, to centre it in this site. And if they have a meal afterwards, that'll be in Meccano. It's made.
And which of the flying boats would be the appropriate one to put in?
I think the Solent.
David, we're here at the hangar at Motap. How do you feel about the old plane?
Could almost be a bit emotional as I flew in the last trip that the flying boat took across the Tasman from Auckland to Sydney and came back in one of the Electras. So I have actually flown in one. I was 17 years old at the time, so it was an experience.
So this is pretty crowded in here. It doesn't really give us much of a sense of what she was like. The improvements that you'd like to make with a display at Mechanics Bay.
Have it on its own, in its own setting. It will only be a couple of hundred yards from where it used to fly out of and come out on the water on those wheels that you can see there for servicing and the likes. And definitely set in a scene where there's an imitation water around the hull up to.
So she'd be sitting on a water line.
Sitting on a water. Yes, that's right. It'll come to life. It's dead here, in a sense.
But I also think that if space is available, and there's all, until a serious costing is done, that you won't know that. But the Sunderland, of course, New Zealand had Sunderlands originally.
It's a fantastic idea, and with the outlook.
Yeah. Yes. It gets you excited just standing here and looking out at all that and picturing it as. What it might look like from the portrayal of the plan that's on paper at the moment.
The Port of Waitemata has undergone many changes in its 150-year history. It used to mimic industrial Britain in the early years with gasworks, coal-fired power station and its meatworks. But where should it be heading in the post-industrial age? I discuss the port's past, present and possible futures with planner and academic researcher Joel Cayford.
Joel, we're looking at the Phase 2 port study in the round. The scope could be bigger than Ben-Hur, but I don't think that'll go anywhere. People like George Wood would like it to sink the study by going down that route, perhaps. If we look at the event horizon that you think would work, what are the confines of a study?
Yeah, well, it's an interesting time, and the study's been brought forward, and it does seem to be, it's a sort of a convenient way of appearing to be doing something. The council is appearing to be doing something which can be put out there as a reason for delaying starting work on the B2 and B3 extensions. So it's, I think it's always good to stop bad things from happening. So that's a good step. I think that it's good to see Len and Penny both moving in the direction that they are. But I think the public look at them and say, you do own the port. You are dependent on the port for a revenue stream, and you do run the port on behalf of businesses that rely on the port as well. So talking about going thermonuclear lacks credibility in a way, because really, as the custodian of the port and of the harbour, you need to be taking a very, very balanced view. And as I say, talking of thermonuclear doesn't really cut it. But I think a study is useful. My problem with the study is that if you end up counting cranes and how many square metres of land there is that's been reclaimed and how many TEUs per year you can put through, then you can make a case for saying that having ports competing with each other is good for the port activity. It's good for container importer and exporter. But it doesn't really look at the wider questions that are now arising. And I suppose the simplest one that's here is that I tend to use the analogy that the port in Waitemata Harbour is a bit like a cuckoo in a nest. And you know the cuckoo is fine for a while when it's a little cuckoo. But as soon as it kind of gets a bit big and a bit fat, it kind of outgrows the nest and starts kind of, rocking the boat, as it were. The main thing that we have in our harbour, we know, is that we can take between 13 metre and 12 and a half metre draft ships. And anything bigger than that, and we're told that all of the port expansions to do with hosting bigger ships, will require more dredging, probably explosives because a large part of it is rock, to get it down to, say, 15 metres. And that's the sort of, if you like, the elephant in the room of expanding the port. There's no point in expanding the port in terms of its land area if you don't also dredge the harbour. And so no one's talking about that. So it's all incremental here.
So really there might be one of those parameters, might be the depth at mean high water.
Absolutely. Well, you'd say it's a limiting factor in terms of where you would place your port. You would say that it would be rational to say this is really requiring deep water ports for the future, 16 metres being the minimum. And where do we have ports that are like that? Tauranga is close to that. They did some dredging, so they're very close to that now. They planned for that. So if you like, theirs was a holistic plan. They talked about reclamation, they talked about TEU handling areas and cranes, and they talked about depths all in one go. So you can see that's a one-stop shop. Auckland's not a one-stop shop.
So if we say that perhaps that there is going to be a constraint on size, then we look at the constraint on perhaps length of the vessel and also the number of vessels we can handle at once. Essentially, there is capacity for more wharfage, longer wharfage with the bulk oil terminal once the tank farm's gone. Is that something we should be factoring in?
Well, we should be probably talking more like a 724 thing. I've heard a lot of people joke about, you know, how many hours are the cranes actually used in the Port of Auckland. They sort of lie idle for a lot of the time because it's a sort of a daylight hours only operation. I mean, some things happen at night. But you go around ports around the world and say, let's say Singapore is a really, really large port, and we've all flown in and out of Singapore, and you see how many ships are at anchor. They're not in port. They can't go in, so they're queued.
That's right. There is a queue system.
And yeah, that's designed. There's no reason why we can't have a queue system. And so that, and it's not so much to make sure that ships only come in and out at high water, though you could be getting into that. But there are other ways of using the port more efficiently, 24 hours a day, et cetera, which don't seem to have been explored. But I'm not an expert on port logistics, I'm not qualified to talk about that. What I feel I'm experienced in talking about is that the narrow quantitative assessment that is often in these port studies, how many cranes, how much land area, how many TEUs, all of that, ignores the bigger questions that you and I might be wanting to ask, which are, what about Waitemata Harbour? It is a scarce resource. How much of it should be used for these kinds of purposes versus other purposes? We've got heritage issues that are emerging. We've got recreational issues that are emerging. People are saying, why can't we host another America's Cup? Or was the Volvo very successful? And you're looking at the compromises that are being imposed on those kinds of possibilities by a port expansion.
So from a planning perspective then, you're looking and trying to balance the recreational need and the commercial need.
Well, all of the needs really, because to me, at the moment, ships can use Auckland's port and be charged about $200 to offload a container, $200 to upload a container, whereas it's about $400 for the same transaction in Australian ports. Where, if you like, the true costs, I would say, are being borne by the container handlers. The subsidy that Auckland is offering so that we get this bargain basement cost for container handling, the harbour is subsidising it, you and I are subsidising it, as more and more space is taken up for cars, for containers or whatever. And particularly the road network and the users of the road network are also subsidising it because they're having to share it with trucks carrying containers. It's not an ideally located port now for the kind of traffic that they're wanting to bring into Auckland in the future.
I'm interested in that idea of subsidy because that's critical, isn't it? Essentially, you're saying that we're offsetting the cost, the true cost, by taking a hit as users of Auckland. I mean, in terms of the infrastructure, roads, etc., etc. What would... How would we work that into a scope?
Well, I think what you would do is that you would, you have to look, when you're doing a benefit cost assessment of options, which many of these things do come down to, you make a deliberate attempt to include all of the benefits and all of the costs. You don't just kind of confine it to cranes and reclaimed land and containers. You have to look at the road network. You have to look at the water network, which is the Waitemata Harbour in our case, and the channel and all of those kinds of things. And what are the costs of expanding the port activity for the rest of the community? Not just the cost of kind of reclamation or building a wharf or adding a crane, because those are the narrow costs that sort of get into this very narrow port versus port argument, which allows the cuckoo to kind of grow and grow in the nest until it's, you know, outgrown the nest. We need now, I think those kind of arguments were okay maybe 20 years ago and prior, but as cities and as Auckland is becoming more passionate about its harbour, about how it could be used, about how the harbour edges can be used for cycling, for walking, for events like triathlons, all of those kinds of things, there's more and more of that kind of activity that's called for. It also includes access to the water and boating activities. Then that is a use which has real economic and social benefits and brings all sorts of money into the economy. And if you're going to talk about cruise ships, for example, those kind of activities and things like that are far more attractive to cruise ship passengers than ports. Not saying I'm not one who argues for the port to be moved, but I think that we need in Auckland more what I describe as a boutique port. And so the kinds of activities and the kind of trade that go through it are ones that should go through it, must go through it, because it's rational. Whereas other kind of bulk things like break bulk cars and some of the bulk other cargoes, that they go from other ports. They don't need to be trucked into and out of Auckland.
Well, one of the issues that the South and the West would bring up against that is the $250 million worth of income that comes off of the car wholesale importing per year, 2,500 jobs dependent on that in the South. You're suggesting that business should go elsewhere?
Well, I'm really suggesting that, I mean, Auckland used to be, if you like, a little model of industrial Britain. We had a lot of meatworks, we had a lot of freezing works, we had coal-fired power stations to generate electricity, we had all of these kinds of things. And then gradually Auckland has become more of a, I suppose a consumer city. And it's more conscious of its environment rather than sort of an industrial production city. So that people still want their TVs and they still want their cars and stuff like that. We need to be thinking about ways of bringing those in. If you're talking about knowledge economy, you're talking about waterfronts that are going to attract your advertisers, your architects, all of those kind of design, those sort of the new age industries that we want, then you need less heavy industry or less kind of heavy port industry and more things that attract those kind of that kind of economy. So things don't happen overnight. It's a transition, I suppose, I'm talking about.
So this is really a middle class, working class issue, essentially, where we're saying in the South, look, there are jobs out of that port down there. You're saying they should go elsewhere, or it should be part of the study anyway.
Well, there's a lot of what you're talking about middle class, working class. I think that in Auckland already, there are a lot of what you would describe perhaps as unskilled jobs that are with the economy now. And this is all sections of the economy. There are unskilled jobs. But there are also skilled craftspeople type jobs that are growing as well, whether it's with the boat industry or there's a lot of different types of buildings that are going up now, different kinds of skills that are required there. I think we're in transition.
So finally then, just looking at a separate part of this, perhaps the study, which hasn't been discussed by council as far as I know, and that's this triple hat ownership, governorship, regulation of ports by Auckland Council. Should that be included in the scope?
I think a national approach needs to be taken in terms of ports. We are overported. And the cost is essentially being borne by communities through their rates. So there's a race. I mean, some use the term the race to the bottom, but it's more like a race to the top. So all of the ports are trying to kind of be the port to be chosen by Maersk or other operators to offload containers. So they're all trying to provide the same facility in terms of container storage space and cranes and all of that. They all want that revenue. They all want the containers to go through there. And it's a look at me, and there's a beauty contest that's happening around New Zealand that is being subsidised through waterfronts, transport, but also actual ratepayer money going into these constructions. And you say this is not an efficient use of ratepayer dollar, which could be being spent on other things, like roading, swimming pools, libraries and things like that. All good for the economy. But rather than having all of these ports, let's have two or three. So I'd like to see the government, I think the government needs to be involved in that. They do that with roads, national roads of importance. Ports of importance, the same kind of thing.
Ports of importance.
And so I think that should be happening there. In terms of the study, by all means do the study. But in my view, the government needs to be much, much more involved in it, because the market is not going to deliver the benefits if all of the costs are included. And in terms of what our council does, then it is very motivated to do whatever it can to increase the port's success, make it more successful as business. And whether it's through real estate, through more reclamation, whether it's through more cars coming in, whether it's through more containers coming in, that's good for the council because it's good for their bottom line and they like that. So that they need to, I mean, it needs to be very carefully recognised that that's the case. And then in terms of consenting activities for the port, then it seems to me to be terribly evident the port, that the council are terribly conflicted here, is in terms of they don't treat the port like, to me, they would treat a private operator wanting to do a reclamation outside their house, you know, in the estuary. They're not treating them the same way at all. You know, would they be non-notified, those consents? I would suggest not. I think that in terms of if the council really wants to show that it's serious about looking in the mirror, then I think it should formally review the consenting process that its officers and that its agency conducted in terms of the port. We don't reflect very much on things that we've done badly. We just move on, layer over it, pour oil on top of water.
That's an issue, isn't it?
We apologise that episode 57 didn't air at the advertised time last week. The studio had a programming glitch. The show is available on demand at www.allaboutauckland.com and will replay this Tuesday on Face TV at 12:30 p.m. Thanks for watching the All About Auckland show. I hope you found the ideas interesting. To watch the show again or sign up for our newsletter, go to www.allaboutauckland.com. You can follow us on Facebook or via our Twitter handle, All About AKL. See you next week.